Good afternoon, friends. On behalf of School of Engineering and Technology, Indira Gandhi National Open University, I, Rakesh Sharma, Program Coordinator, ACPDM, welcome you all. It's our privilege to have experts with us, Mrs. Anjali Chandra, Director of Finance CEA, and Mr. V.S. Verma.
Member
Planning, CEA. So now I request Mrs. Anjali Chandra to start the...
Welcome friends to this session. We were talking about substations and lines. We had covered substations. Now we move on to distribution lines. So the definition of a feeder is that the feeder consists of all primary or secondary voltage level segments of distribution lines between two substations or between a substation and an open point. That is the definition of feeder. It could be between two substations or it could be between a substation and an open line. For example, an 11 kV feeder emanates from a 33 by 11 kV substation and ends in an open point. Similarly, from a distribution transformer, the LT feeder emanates from the distribution substation and ends at the consumer premises. So that is the definition of a feeder. You can see this is a feeder from a distribution substation, from a 33 by 11 kV substation. So the feeders are connected in a configuration which depends on the type of network required in the distribution system. Three types of networks are normally available in the electrical distribution system. That is the radial, loop and cross loop network. We'll discuss all these three. What is the radial system, what is the loop and what is the cross loop network. The distribution feeders are considered to be radial when they emanate from one point and end at the other in the network. Load transfer in this case, in the case of breakdown, is not possible. And although a radial feeder can be loaded to its maximum capacity, in case of breakdown, quite a large area may remain in dark until the fault is detected and repaired. You can see a radial network. This emanates from the substation and that ends at various points. So there is no alternative supply available. From the distribution substation, we have the LT feeder and it ends at the consumer. And in case of a breakdown on the distribution substation, the whole area will be in darkness. Then we have the loop feeder. In loop arrangement, two feeders are connected to each other so that in case of breakdown, the faulty section can be isolated and the rest of the portion can be switched on. In this type of system, the feeder is normally loaded to 70% of its capacity so that in the event of breakdown, it can share the load of other feeders also. So if you want load sharing, you should load it only up to 70% so that essential loads of the faulty feeder can be shifted to another feeder. This is depicted in this diagram where both the feeders are interconnected and are isolated at any point. You can isolate them or interconnect them depending upon the requirement. Then we have distribution feeders which are the cross loop type or mesh type. A cross loop network provides multiple paths and the flexibility further increases. In case of breakdown in any line, the faulty system can be isolated and supply can be resumed very quickly. In this type of network, feeders again should normally be loaded to 70% of their current carrying capacity. This system is highly reliable but very expensive. Naturally, if you are going to give alternate feeds, provide alternate feeds, you cannot load the line up to 100% of its capacity. And secondly, you will have to provide alternate paths. Therefore, the system is very expensive. In 11 kV, you can see the diagram of a cross loop network. You have two like points in the right hand corner. You have three supplies. So, if one supply goes off, then the other supply is going to work. And even if that goes off, then the third supply is going to work. This is done for very, very essential locations, in, especially at the 11 kV and delta level. In transmission, you generally do this, but in distribution, you do this only for very, very essential loads like hospitals or maybe VIP locations where the where there is the residence of VIPs. Otherwise, this system is normally not used. And this can be done at 11 kV feeder level through ring main units. If you've heard of ring main units, then the ring main units, which consists of the breakers and isolators, provides this sort of system where you can put on, isolate one section and put on the supply from another 11 kV feeder if the feeder is faulty. So these are the three types of distribution systems available. And where do we use them? What is the comparative comparative statement? We are going to see this. The radial distribution system, the loop distribution system, and the cross loop or mesh system. In the radial distribution system, single path to each group of consumers is there. In the loop distribution system, double path to each group of customers is there. Whereas in the cross loop system, multiple paths to each group of customers. Then the radial distribution system has the lowest construction cost. The loop distribution system has medium cost, whereas the cross loop network has a high cost. If you're going to provide multiple paths, your cost is going to be high. The radial system is very easy to plan, design and operate. The loop distribution system is moderately simple to plan, design and operate, whereas the cross loop network distribution system is complex to plan, design and operate because of the various paths provided. The liability in case of radial distribution systems is less. It is more in loop distribution system, and the cross loops network distribution system is the most reliable. So the radial distribution system is generally used in rural areas. Loop distribution system should be used in urban areas, and the cross loop network naturally has to be used in urban areas. Though we are using radial system also in urban areas, that because of the cost involved in the creating loops.
But can you say how are the distribution losses in the three systems?
So the distribution loss will depend on the loading of the system. Basically, this is you are trying to operate the system at lesser loading in cross loop and loop distribution system. So losses will be, the lines will be more, losses in the each section of the line will be less. So you have to work out what will be the losses in each case, because the loading is going to vary. Your line may actually, your line current may be carried by any one of the paths. So loss in all the three sections should remain the same.
I mean,
likely losses. Yeah, okay. If you are, well, because at a time only one path is going to be used.
But then suppose the cross loop system which you have made,
yes,
that comes into operation because of the one not being
so
available.
Then two other paths will carry their load.
So the losses might increase?
Might increase. That can happen. But then at this, this system is mainly to increase the reliability, not to reduce the losses. The whole idea of this providing a cross-loop or mesh network is to improve the reliability. Because it's very essential at some points that the continuous supply is maintained. So especially in metros and big cities or in
hospitals
or essential services like the airport, the military areas or defense installations. So this type of system is used there. Where you can afford to have put in a larger cost to improve the reliability.
Okay.
Then we have the lines can be, distribution lines or feeders can be overhead or underground. We have both types of system in the country. Though most of the system in our country is overhead, underground is about one-tenth of the overhead lines in our country, rather even less than that. So we'll discuss overhead lines first. What are the main items used for overhead lines? Then we'll go on to underground and also discuss the comparison between overhead lines and underground cables, where overhead lines are preferred and where underground cables are preferred and why. That will come to later. First, we'll discuss the overhead lines. In the overhead lines, the main items are supports, insulators, conductor, cross arm and clamps of various types, stay fits, stay wire, strain hardware sets, and earthing set. These are the major items which are used for construction of overhead lines, whether they are 33 kV, 11 kV, or LT. So you can see this one of the lines in the slide. We'll go on to discuss the what are the types of supports we can use for 33 kV lines, 11 kV lines, and LT lines.
There is a call from Delhi.
Yes.
Yes, Delhi. Please ask your question.
Hello.
Yes.
Hello.
Yes.
Sir, my question is relating to surge arrestor.
Pardon?
Surge arrestor.
When we install the surge arrestor across a transformer.
Yes.
What is the exact rating of the surge arrestor to be installed? Suppose that the transformer is 33/11 kV.
Yes. You want 33/11 kV or 11/0.4 kV?
I mean 33/11 kV.
Okay. For the 33/11 kV, the surge arrestor should be rated for 30 kV and nominal discharge current rating should be 10 kilo ampere.
According to me, it should be more than 33 kV.
Yes.
I think there is some interruption, technical slack. So please continue.
Okay, should I continue with the answer or with the
answer? Yes, continue with the answer first.
The surge arrestor at 33 kV is generally rated for 30 kV and for the nominal discharge current rating of 10 kilo ampere. And its rated voltage of the lightning arrestor at 11 kV should be 9 kV for effectively a system. The discharge, nominal discharge rating is 5 kilo ampere for this. I hope this answers your question.
These are standard ratings?
Yes, these are standard ratings. Generally, these are used. And the surge arrestor on the 33 kV side should be station class, heavy duty, gapless metal oxide type surge diverter. And the arrestor should conform to IS 3070. So I hope this answers your question.
Proceed.
I think should we move forward?
Yeah, proceed, sir.
So we were talking about distribution overhead lines. We were talking about supports. The principal types of line supports are wood poles, concrete poles, steel tubular poles, rails or RS joists, and lattice type supports. These are the main types of supports used in distribution. We will discuss these. The wood poles are chemically treated wood poles are used in distribution lines. Wooden poles are cheap, low in cost, but they are susceptible to decay. And the specification of wood poles are covered by IS 876 and IS 5978. So earlier we were using wood poles only, but now we are using other types of poles. The timber suitable for wooden poles is classified in three groups according to its strength. Group A, very strong timber with modulus of rupture and bending above 850 kg per centimeter square, such as sal. Group B, strong timber with modulus of rupture 630 to 850 kg per centimeter square. This is teak and sisal. Group C, moderately strong timber with modulus of rupture in the range of 450 to 630 kg centimeter square. Under group C come cheer and deodar, etc. These are still prevalent in our country. In J&K, we have many wooden poles, though they are now slowly being replaced by the concrete and the steel tubular poles. Wooden poles have further been grouped in several classes according to the ultimate taking load. class 1, ultimate breaking load not less than 1350 kg. Class 2, ultimate breaking load between 1100 to 1350 kg. Class 3, the breaking load is between 850 to 1100 kg. Class 4 is 700 to 850 kg. Class 5, 550 to 700 kg. Class 6, 400 to 550 kg. And class 7, 300 to 400 kg. This is the classification depending upon the ultimate breaking load.
But where do we use various classifications?
That depends on the, we'll come to that, the how do you choose a pole?
How do you choose a pole?
What are the loads incident on the pole? We'll just come to that after discussing the various types of poles. So concrete poles are of three types. The precast cement concrete poles, which we commonly refer to as PCC poles. Then there are reinforced cement concrete poles, which are referred to as RCC. And the third type of concrete poles are pre-stressed cement concrete poles, which are called PSCC. I think these are the common names used. The RCC poles have an extremely long life and need little maintenance, but they are bulky in size and are comparatively heavy. They have shattering tendency when hit by a vehicle. PSC poles take care of these shortcomings to some extent. However, the handling, transportation and erection of these poles is more difficult because of their heavy weight. These concrete poles are more expensive than wood poles but cheaper than steel tubular poles. That is why they are extensively used in our country. They are extensively used for power distribution lines in urban areas and in remote and inaccessible places, as RCC can be manufactured at the site itself. They are also preferred where decorative considerations predominate. Concrete of ratio 1:1:5:3 with 15 mm size, well graded shingle is used for their manufacture. Then we have the steel tubular poles. The specifications for steel tubular poles are covered by IS 2713. Due to their light weight, high strength to weight ratio and long life, they possess distinct advantage. They are of two types. They are step type and swag type. So each has its own advantage. Step poles are manufactured from a single tube, the diameter being reduced in parallel steps by passing the tube through a series of dies. The use of a pole cap at the top concrete mass in the ground and regular coating of paint prolongs their life. Otherwise, the steel will get decayed. So we use a concrete mass in the ground. You must have seen an installation of a steel tubular pole. Then we can use these rails and RS joints also, joists also, for erecting the distribution lines. Old and second-hand rails and RS joists are frequently used as supports for distribution lines. The working load of rails and RS joints is again, joists is again given. The rail pole usually has a length of 9 meter, its planting depth is 1.5 meter, distance of load from top is 0.30 meter and working load is 175. We have different sizes in the rail poles, rail of 29.74 kg per meter, rail of 37.17 kg per meter, rail of 44.61 kg per meter, and the working loads are different. You can select the rail according to the working load or the forces incident on the pole. We'll come to that. Then we have the ISMB 125 mm into 75 mm RS joists, or we have 150 mm into 80 mm. So 150 mm into 80 mm has a working load of 222 kg.
These are the weights of the rail, 29 kg per meter or something.
Kg per meter
is the weight of the rail pole.
And the height, like if it is 9 meter or 11 meter, depending on whether it is going to be used for 11 kV or it is going to be used for 33 kV. So different, if depending on the clearance for the voltage, you choose a different height of the pole. Then we have the lattice type supports. These lattice type supports are more expensive than the poles, but these are used where we have where sludgy area, where the marshy area, or where the wind is very high, because these are narrow based tower structures. They are light in weight and economical, and can be assembled at site if bolted construction is used. Both welded or bolted types are used. If you have a problem of transportation, then you can use the bolted type. The portion embedded in the ground is protected by concrete muffs, and the remaining portion by regular paint unless galvanized steel is used. So if you are using this type of support, then you either have to galvanize the steel or do painting, otherwise it might corrode by the moisture in the air. So these are the various types of supports that we are using. The now comes like what Mr. Verma was saying, how do we select the size and height of the pole? Depends upon the span length, the voltage level, the conductor size and tension, the phase and ground clearances as specified in IE rules, then the forces acting on the pole, which is the self weight, the weight of the conductor, the ice loading, the wind pressure on pole, and the weight of the cross arms and conductors. So all these forces act on the pole, so you have to select it depending, taking the all these weights into consideration, or all these forces into consideration. The planting depth varies from 1/6 to 1/10 of pole height. Usually it is between 1500 cm to 1800 cm. You should have more of length inside if your wind loading is higher and you think the stresses are higher on the pole, then you should have a higher size. But it is taken from 1/6 to 1/10 of the pole, the planting depth. Then the next major equipment used in lines is insulators. An electrical insulator resists the flow of electricity, as we all know. Application of a voltage difference across a good insulator results in negligible electrical current. Insulators keep electrical current from energizing the power pole. The basic function of use of insulator in overhead lines is to keep the electrical current from energizing the pole, because that will cause shock, and anyone touching the pole, if insulators are not used, would get a very hefty shock.
This is a call from Pune.
Yes.
Yes, Pune.
Hello.
Yes,
Planting depth means that the pole has to be put inside the earth, and the length of the pole which goes into the earth is known as the planting depth. Because does that answer your question?
Okay.
It is just the higher length of the pole which goes into the ground. Then we move on to insulators. The insulators used in connection with overhead lines are shackle insulators, pin type insulators, suspension type insulators, guy strain insulators, and post type. We'll discuss these insulators in detail, where these are to be used. The shackle insulators. The shackle insulators are used for LT lines, that is the 400 and 230 volt lines, for tension as well as tangent locations. Shackle insulators are used for distribution lines, dead ending, and supporting conductors in vertical formation. The specifications of shackle insulators are given in IS 1445, and they cover shackle insulators for voltages below 1000 volts. The two standard sizes listed in this specification are 19 mm dia and 75 mm height, and the other size given is 115 mm dia and 100 mm height. The shackle insulator is supported by two straps and two MS bolts, or one U clamp or D strap and two MS bolts. That's how it is put on the line. Then we have the pin insulators.
Do you have any images or photographs of these?
Yes, I have for pin insulators and suspension insulators, but I could not get one for shackle insulators. Yeah. Shackle insulators everybody has seen because they are on every LT line, so okay. I could. Well, I have an image of a pin insulator, I'll show that. These pin insulators, these are manufactured for voltages up to 33 kV and are cheaper than the other types. IS 1445 and 731 cover detailed specifications for these. Typical dimensions for these as per specifications are given below. For 11 kV we have a maximum dia of 152 mm and height is 137. For 22 kV the maximum diameter is 210 mm and height is 195. For 33 kV the maximum diameter is 278 and height is 242 mm. Here we have an image of the 33 kV type pin type insulator. So you can see the image like what you were saying. This is a pin type insulator for 33 kV. This is a pin type insulator for 11 kV. So these are mostly used at 11 kV and 33 kV. Shackle insulators are used for LT. And these are the images of the pin type insulators.
From Allahabad.
Yes.
Yes, Allahabad. Please ask your question.
You have talked about the various types of pools.
Yes.
Can you also tell us something about the various types of foundations which are used?
Various types of foundation. Actually, pools are generally put in concrete and concrete muff is formed around the poles.
Is there some hardness?
Pardon? Please ask again.
Some standard, some chart,
yes.
Or some
really yes, this is given in IS 1445. You can see usually, you know, there is an IS for the overhead lines. Achha, you want to know where that is given? Just a minute.
About the foundations.
Foundations, okay. Let me see if I have the IS here. You may see in IS 2713 or in this. IS 876 or IS 5978. These are the various IS for poles. You can see in these IS. It is definitely given that what should be the depth of the pole and what should bear concrete muff and how it is to be placed, how the line is to be drawn, everything is given in the IS. Methodology for constructing the line is also given. So we were talking about insulators. We have the shackle insulators, then the pin insulators, then we have the suspension insulators. Pin insulators are also called suspension insulators. The cost of a pin insulator increases very rapidly as the working voltage is increased. For high voltages, this type is therefore uneconomical, and there is the further disadvantage that replacements are expensive. For these reasons, high voltage lines are insulated by means of suspension insulators, in which the line conductor is suspended below the point of support by means of insulator or insulators, depending on the voltage level. The disc of the suspension insulator. We have many discs in the suspension insulator, so I am talking about one disc. The suspension insulator consists of a single disc-shaped piece of porcelain grooved on the undersurface to increase the surface leakage path, and to a metal cap at the top and to a metal pin underneath. The cap is recessed so as to take the pin of another unit, and in this way a string of any required number of units can be built up. The cap is secured to the insulator by means of cement. I'll show you a disc of the suspension insulator. You can see that this is a disc of the suspension insulator. Many discs can be used together. For 33 kV, for example, we'll have three discs together. This is another version of the suspension disc insulator. These disc insulators are made of glazed porcelain or tough glass. Single stack polymer insulators are used in operating the existing lines. The specifications for disc insulators are covered by IS 731 and their dimensions have been standardized in IS 3188.
I have a question. Yes. From you. You showed the insulator for 33 kV, 11 kV and all.
Yes.
If the insulator design is fixed for 33 kV, then why have you to apply number of discs in case?
So that was thin insulator. Now this is a disc insulator.
Okay.
So there are different places where these are used. Disc insulators are used for tangent locations or...
My question is, can you do with one disc or one insulator?
No, it depends on the voltage rating. If it is 11 kV, you will have one disc. If you have 33 kV, you will have three discs.
Three discs.
If you have 66 kV, you will have six discs.
So for 66 kV, it is not possible to have one disc?
No, because the disc is rated for one voltage, 11 kV.
11 kV, that
yes.
is okay.
Hello?
Yes.
Yeah.
Hello?
Yes.
Please ask a question.
Insulators, what is meant by retail distance? What is the advantage?
Pardon? Can you repeat your question?
What do you mean by creepage distance?
Creepage distance.
Creepage distance from the insulator.
And one more.
Yes.
What is the advantage? Is there any IR to keep the maximum creepage distance or minimum creepage distance?
The maximum creepage, yes, there is an IS for the creepage distance. Most probably it is the maximum creepage distance. Actually, creepage distance, dust and pollution comes on the disc. So it defines that how much is the clean porcelain on the porcelain disc, and that distance should be maintained. If it goes less than this, then there will be a flashover on the disc. So that is the meaning of creepage distance actually in an insulator. And this is defined by an IS. I don't remember the exact IS, but I can let you know next time. It is defined in the IS for insulators. And it is also defined in our construction standards. If you want to see this creepage distance, you can go to CA website, which is ca.nic.in. On that we have this draft construction standards. If you go to that and then go to in the draft construction standards are for generation, transmission and distribution. So in distribution you will have the creepage distance for various voltage levels. You can go and see that.
Yes, Delhi, please ask a question.
Actually, ma'am.
Yes.
Can you give the definition of what is the meaning of the rated voltage of a subtractor? Because I am not able to understand.
Yes.
Why it is less than the system voltage?
The rated voltage of what?
Hello?
Yes.
What is the exact meaning of the rated voltage of a subtractor?
You answered that question earlier. He asked why it is less than the rated voltage.
It is less than the rated voltage of the... Because it has to flash over at the lightning. Surge arrestor is basically to, you know, contain the dynamic over voltages in the system or to contain the lightning of the, flashover on lightning. It should divert the if it is equal to the voltage of the system, then the surge will be diverted to the system. It has to divert that surge to the earth. So that is why the voltage is less, actually.
Okay.
Next is suspension insulator. We were talking about disc or suspension insulators. Each insulator is designed for a comparatively low working voltage, usually about 11,000 volts or 11 kV. And the insulation for any required line voltage can be obtained by using a string of suitable number of such insulators. That's what I was telling you, that each disc is designed for 11 kV. 3 numbers for 33 kV in series and 1 number for 11 kV you use. For 66 kV you will use 6 this. In the event of a...
So far they could not be designed for a higher voltage level?
No, sir. The basic idea is that, you know, in the event of failure of one insulator, you need to replace only
this
one.
This is a major advantage.
This is a major advantage that you will have to replace only one disc. Otherwise, you will have to replace the whole disc. So, inside polymer, it will become relatively expensive. So, if you know one disc is chipped off, you can replace only one disc. Otherwise, you will have to replace the entire disc unit. All the insulators. The method of attaching suspension insulator string varies. In one of the attachment methods, a U-bolt is fastened on the underside of the cross arm to which the insulator hardware it is attached. This would provide flexibility both longitudinally and transversely. In another method of attachment is in the form of a bent plate or angle which is fastened to the underside of the cross arm with a sufficient hole to receive a hook or shackle at the top of the insulator spring. Suspension insulators are used for tangent and angle construction for all voltage lines. Usually pin type or post type insulators are used on overhead lines with not more than 70 kV. Above 70 kV you are usually using suspension insulators only, but these are used below 70 kV on tangent and angle locations. Suspension insulators are used also for dead-ending lines of any voltage, as for example road crossings, junctions of overhead lines with cables.
All from Delhi again.
Yes.
Delhi, ask the question please.
Sorry ma'am, I am again disturbing you.
Yes.
No problem, you can ask.
Ma'am, jaise aap keh rahi hai ki wo usse kam hona chahiye voltage.
Yes.
तो वो तो मैडम सिस्टम वोल्टेज पर ही फ्लैश ओवर कर जाएगा, जबकि हमें उसे तो लाइटिंग वोल्टेज या सर्ज वोल्टेज पर फ्लैश ओवर कराना
है। बट देन यू नो
सिस्टम वोल्टेज हमारा 33 के भी है।
यस।
और वो हमारे पैक उसके सिस्टम के पैरेलल में लगा हुआ है।
नहीं, वो उसके ऊपर लगा होता है ना, तो पहले ही वो लाइटनिंग अरेस्टर जनरली एट द टॉप मोस्ट लोकेशन, it is not at the bottom location. So when it is at the topmost location, the lightning will arrest, come to that first instead of going to the system.
And current always flows from higher potential to lower potential.
So that we don't want that actually.
Yeah. Hello.
Yes.
हाँ मैम वो ठीक है, लेकिन जैसे ट्रांसफार्मर के पैरेलल में वो लगा है।
पैरेलल में तो लगा है, लेकिन ऊपर लगा है ना, पहले लगा है वो।
पहले लगाया है, लेकिन जो सिस्टम का जो वोल्टेज है वो उसके अक्रॉस भी तो आ रहा है।
नहीं, इट विल कम आफ्टरवर्ड्स टू दैट, सो इट विल फर्स्ट गो टू द अर्थ। आई थिंक वी कैन इफ यू वांट मोर डिटेल, इफ यू वांट मोर डिटेल
नहीं हो रहा।
नहीं, आपको अगर बहुत ज्यादा डिटेल चाहिए सर्ज अरेस्टर, देन यू कम टू माय ऑफिस विच इज इन आर के पुरम, यू कम टू सेवा भवन, देन वी कैन डिस्कस दिस इन डिटेल। You can always, since you are in Delhi, you can always come to RK Puram and we'll discuss this.
Or mail.
Yeah, my mail ID is, or you put your question on my mail ID, which is anjuli_cea@yahoo.co.in.
Yeah, you have any question regarding this distribution equipments, you can ask and you can mail her.
Mail it to me, so then I'll discuss this in detail with you. So we were talking about suspension and disc insulators. These suspension insulators are used for dead-ending of lines of any voltage. For example, some road crossings, junctions of overhead lines with cables, river crossings, at angle towers where there is a change in the direction of line and so on. In some, although the conductors of low voltage distribution lines are often dead-ended on double arm constructions using thin insulators, where the tension is exceedingly high, as at long river spans, 2, 3, or even 4 strings of insulators in parallel have been used. It will be realized that when used as thin insulators, the discs are in a vertical instead of a horizontal plane. These suspension insulators are either, they have two types, ball and socket coupling type or clevis and tongue coupling type. Both connection types are used, and the dimensions of these disc insulators for ball and socket type are: type 1, nominal diameter is 255 mm and nominal spacing is 145 mm. Type 2, the nominal diameter is 280 mm and nominal spacing is 170 mm. This is also given in the IS for the disc insulators, which I told you earlier. In the tongue and clevis type, a round pin with a quarter pin is used to hold the tongue of one unit in the clevis of the other. In the case of ball and socket type, the insulators are assembled by sliding the ball of one insulator into the socket of the next insulator from the side. This is, I am telling you how to make strings of the disc insulator. You have like for 33 kV 3 discs, for 66 kV 6. So you, in the tongue and clevis type, there the tongue of one unit goes into the clevis of the other, and in the ball and socket type, the ball of one insulator goes into the socket of the next insulator. So this you can see the picture of a tongue and clevis type of insulator. You please show the picture of this. This is a tongue and clevis type of disc insulator. You can see this. Then this is the actual you can see how it is going. Another view of the tongue and clevis type insulator. This is how the insulator for an 11 kV. You can see this, how it is suspended. Then we move on to the guy strain insulators. I didn't have a picture of the ball and socket type, but I have shown you a picture of the tongue and clevis type. The guy strain insulators, we have the next type of insulators, which are called the guy strain insulators. These are egg type insulators and are used for insulating stray wires, guard wires, etc., wherever it is not proposed to earth them. The insulator is fixed between the guy wire almost in the middle. The bottom portion of the guy wire gets insulated. Any human being or animal coming in contact with the bottom portion will be safe. That is why these insulators are used. Two types are there. The A type and... Yes, you want to say something?
We will take a small break of 15 minutes. Okay, and we will be here sharp 5:30. And we'll continue with this lecture of distribution equipments. So, just take a small break.
Okay.